It is good to see you guys here. My name is Jared Peterson. I'm with Brian Research and Engineering, and I will be talking to you guys about the relief valve block and new block in ProMax 6.0. In this, just to let you know what we'll be discussing the block, how it works, and some of the features of it. This course is specifically not designed to go into all the intricacies of all the intricacies of relief valve sizing. We'll do this through two methods. First off, there will be a lecture portion where I will talk about the block, how it works, and some of the details of it. And then there will be a section where we'll be demonstrating how ProMax works. So let's get started. BRNE 600, the webinar where we talk about the relief valve block. So first off, we're just going to talk very, very quickly about what a relief valve is. A relief valve is there to make sure that your system, if I was to summarize, make sure it does not blow up. If you have some sort of vessel or tank and you do not have a sufficient outlet, but you're putting material in or energy in, it can overpressure the system, which can lead to a rupture of some form. There are lots of things that can cause this material or energy imbalance. Depending on our system, we may need to look at several of these cases for each particular relief valve block we want to put in. So, if I had some sort of vessel and I was worried about a blocked outlet, I would need to do a relief valve sizing for a blocked outlet. If I was worried about some sort of utility failure in it as well, I would need to look at that. If I was also potentially worried about a control valve failure, I'd need to look at that. So I would need to look at each of the possible cases that could occur, or at least each of the practical possible cases, and then figure out which one is going to result in a relief, or which of these would result in the largest relief valve size, because I would need to size my relief valve for the largest of these cases. In theory, we could have multiple relief valves, and sometimes that is the correct answer, but in many cases, we do just want one relief valve, so you want it to make sure that relief valve is large enough to handle the maximum flow that could result through it. So, with that said, in ProMax, to help you do this, we do have a new relief valve block. You can find it under ProMax Valves, the ProMax Valve Stencil. Down at the bottom, there's something called Relief Valve, and it looks like this. Let's talk about it. When you double-click on the relief valve and go into the Process Data tab, you get something that looks like this. Over here on the left-hand side, you will notice there are a number of sub-tabs. These sub-tabs are much like a column, and we will go into detail on what they are. The contingency sub-tab is the first one we're going to talk about, and it looks about like this. What you would have is you would select what stream you're referencing, if you'd like to so do, and you have the option of creating either a living stream or a living copy of that stream or a dead copy, meaning you can create a copy, you can have the relief valve copy a stream, and if the stream changes, it dynamically changes the values in here. Or you can have it be a dead copy, meaning you copy the stream, and then these values in here no longer update with the stream. It will populate with all these values. You can, of course, enter them manually if you prefer. Under the Specifications tab, there are two major subsections. There is the Global tab up at the top. These are for standard values that you're going to want across all your relief valves. So things like what sort of relief valve standard are you going to use? These would be things like what we would most commonly use, like API 520, or it could be something less common, like some of the European standards, or something like an actual valve manufacturer data. You'd select your valve type, and then the set pressure of the vessel. This is typically going to be the MOP, or the maximum allowable working pressure of the vessel, and then the active case, the case that would populate in the streams. We will see a demonstration of what that means after the lecture portion. Then, as well within the specifications tab, you do need to specify what is happening for each individual valve. Many of these values are mutually exclusive. So, for example, the ones I want to talk about most are the rating sizing specifications. By default, you can have one of these selected. Once you specify one of them, the others gray out. So if, for example, I had a particular stream and I wanted to determine the maximum or the orifice required for that particular mass flow, I would have a mass flow put in here. By default, it will grab this value from the contingencies subtab. If, however, I wanted to rate an existing valve, I could type in under effective discharge area, the discharge area of the valve, or if it was a standard API orifice designation, I could select that from the drop-down list. We can also select a number of valve characteristics. Many of these populate, in fact, these will populate by default according to 520, if it is possible. By default, for example, but there are some options. So for example, by default for multiphase flow, we use the omega method, but direct integration is also an option. The discharge coefficient will be estimated based on 520, but if you have an actual valve, you can override it, and same with the back pressure correction, etc. Once you're done with that, you can move to the results tab, and it will give you a summary of the results of what you would expect to see in that valve. In particular, one thing I haven't talked about and will not be talking about, but I will be demonstrating it, in the down at the bottom under the results, you'll notice there's a section for relief piping summary. What this does is in this valve, you can put piping. You can have an inlet pipe and you can have an outlet pipe, and it will calculate various attributes of that pipe so that you can see what sort of pressure drop you would expect from them, through them, as well as other things related to it. So, assuming there are no questions, let's move on to a demonstration. Now, the demonstration I'm going to do is a very simple demonstration. The purpose of this demonstration isn't to show you all the fancy things this could do, or necessarily to show you how to set up fancy scenarios or things that could occur. Instead, this is to show you a fairly basic case so that we can see how the relief valve block works. So, in this case, what I have is I have a heater treater. For those of you who aren't familiar with it, I just have some sort of vessel, separation vessel, that I'm adding energy to. Upstream of this vessel, there is something that I'm concerned could block. Let's say a compressor. I'm concerned my compressor could break and block flow through it. If that occurs, there could be an overpressure in this vessel. And I want to see what would happen, or what size relief valve I would need for this. So in order to do that, I need to first create my cases, or the possible things that could occur if I get a blocked flow up here. So let's look at some possible cases. Let's pretend for a minute in one case, we have this heater treater overpressures, it pressurizes. And let's pretend that I've got some sort of thermocouple here that's maintaining a constant temperature. One case would be my system overpressures and the temperature stays constant. That's one case. Let's look at another case as well where my system overpressures, but rather than have a constant temperature, my duty stays constant. So let's look at these two cases and compare them. Now, these are fairly simplistic cases. Well, in reality, you would look at what your system is actually going to do, but I'm going to make this simple for the purpose of this. So let's do that. First, I'm going to create the constant temperature case, but I know I'm going to want a constant duty case. So I'm going to copy this energy stream. I'm going to use it later. I am now going to pressurize this vessel. I'm going to say the maximum allowable working pressure is 100 pounds. Because it's a blocked flow case, that's 10% overpressure, so I would expect 110 pounds. That is my relief pressure in this vessel. So I now have a case, I'm at constant temperature, 145, with a pressure of 110. Now I want to run the relief case on this. Now, historically, what you've had to do is you've had to go into the stream and you've had to add in you can add the analysis and say, I want to do 520 on this and do your relief valve sizing there. You still can, but the relief valve block here will allow us to do both of these cases side by side so I can conveniently compare them, as well as have the piping on it. So let's do that. To do that, I'm going to drag this relief valve block out and attach streams to the inlet and outlet. You'll notice that the outlet stream is red, oops, meaning implying that I could specify something in it. There is a pressure here. You could specify the outlet pressure there. Typically speaking, I recommend specifying everything in this valve. So to do that, you double-click on the valve, you go to the process data tab. Just like we saw before, we have the contingencies sub the or excuse me, the sub-tabs here, and we default to the contingencies tab here. Process stream source, I select what stream I would like to use for my reference. So I click on process stream source, go to HT gas, heater treater gas. That is the stream I want to depressure, or excuse me, I want to put the relief valve on. This is currently a living copy, meaning if I change things in my stream, it will change things here. I do not want a living copy. I just want a snapshot of what it looks like right now. So what I'm going to do is take this process stream source now and delete it. This retains all the previous information, but it is no longer dynamically referencing a stream. This is now effectively a dead copy of that stream. So any changes to the stream will not be reflected here. Once I've specified this information, I can move on to the specifications tab. Under the specifications tab, there are two major parts. There is the global section and the individual section. Under the global section, I look and I see my standard, I check my valve type, and the set pressure. The set pressure of my valve is 100 pounds. And the active relief case, which case do I want to actually populate the streams, is relief case one. I don't like the name. Now, I could have renamed it before under contingencies, but I can rename it here too. I'm looking at the active case name and I think I don't like this. This isn't indicative of what sort of case this is representing. So this is going to be a constant temperature case. So I type in constant temperature. This change will be reflected under the contingencies tab, the results tab, etc. There are some toggles here. This calculate case allows me to turn it off if I don't want to do this calculation useful if I have many, many cases and I don't care about some of them. Ignore piping if I want to ignore my piping. I do want to include it. And then the stream condition. What fraction overpressure? Well, the set pressure is 100 pounds with a 10% overpressure. What is my stream back pressure? I'm going to say 10 pounds. This is the pressure that is exerted on the back face of the valve. If I wanted to do the pressure that was exerted on the back of the pipe, I would need to specify this pressure here on the outlet stream, but if I'm looking at just the back pressure on the back end of the valve, it goes there. My valve characteristics, or excuse me, the rating and sizing specifications, I am looking at finding a relief valve size for this particular mass flow. And then I'm okay with the Omega method. I'm only expecting single phase flow anyway, and it will populate the rest here for me. If at any point I do not know what else I need to populate, Promax doesn't require all this, and I get confused, I can either press execute if it is the active case, or I can press this solve cases button down here. What this solve cases button does is attempts to solve all these cases here. So I press solve cases, and it will generate warnings for things I am missing. If I look down here, you can see it says solving inlet pipe for case constant temperature generated a warning. Pipe length must be specified. Oh, pipe to size must be specified. Oh, yeah. I did not ignore piping, so I do need to include some piping. So I'm going to go down here to the valve inlet piping and specify some information for the inlet to the valve. Now I'm going to say before my valve, I've just got a short length of pipe. I'm going to say it's 2 feet of pipe. I am going to say it's a 1-inch pipe. and call it there. For those of you who are familiar with the pipeline block in Promax, this functions very similarly. I can add segments to it. I can delete segments. I can change various pipeline options. I can add elbows and bends and whatever else I want to put in there. These are all options here. I am keeping it simple for the purpose of this webinar, but you can be fancy if you so choose. I am then going to go to my valve outlet piping. I am going to give this and say it's a little longer. I have an 8-foot length of pipe, also with a 1-inch pipe size. Once I've got all that done, let's see if it can calculate now. I press solve, and Promax goes through, and it does the calculation. I can see any warnings associated down here. I could also see them in the Promax warnings, and I'm good to go. If I click on results, I can see the overall results from these calculations. I can see Promax is predicting I need a 0.1322 whatever inch square inch air orifice area. Of course, they don't sell this exact area, but it says according to the API orifice designation, that's an E size valve that has a designation area of 0.196. This gives me a percent utilization of 67%. Not all companies use this, but many companies do. It tells me my mass flux going through, as well as some valve characteristics. Down here at the bottom, I can see some relief piping summary. I can see what sort of piping pressure drop I would expect through this pipe. If I've got a 1-inch pipe, I can see that of my set pressure, I'm only losing 0.2% of it on the inlet, but I've got 5% pressure drop on the outlet. That seems a little large to me. That implies to me that I probably ought to have a larger pipe on the outlet. So I could go here to the outlet, change it to 2, and solve cases, and I can now see this number significantly smaller. Okay. So now that I've done that, I have my constant temperature case created. Now let's create a constant duty case so we can compare it. So now what I'm going to do is delete this temperature, detach this stream, and attach this energy stream I had copied previously. I now have this gas coming out at 154 degrees. It also has a higher or larger mass flow rate. This implies to me that this relief valve is going to be larger. That's okay. We kind of know this. The first case was somewhat silly. That's okay. We're just doing this to see how this would work. I'm going to create a new case. This time I'm going to name it immediately because I know I need to do that. I'm going to name it Constant Duty. And I am going to reference that same stream. I now have a living copy of that stream. You'll notice it is different than the previous version. I now want this to be a dead copy, so I'm going to delete this, and I now have a copy of that stream. I'm now going to go to specifications, put in the same back pressure, I have the different flow, I'm happy with that, and press solve. By default, it will use the same pipeline information that I had before. And I say by default, it assumes that your piping is going to be the same for all your cases, which is usually a pretty good assumption. I can then go to results and I can compare my results back to back. And I can see these results are fairly similar as I would expect, but that the constant duty case is larger. If I was then going to send this system to, for example, a flare header network, I would say, well, this is the case I want to send to the flare header network. So I would go to active case and change it to constant duty. Once I execute it then, these outlet and inlet conditions will be derived from the constant duty case instead of the constant temperature case because it is the active case. Whatever the active case is the case that will populate in these outlet streams. So now I have my relief valve set up. I can compare and I say, okay, the constant duty case is the one I'm concerned about. So that's step one, sizing our relief valve. Then, of course, we do need to verify with the vendor. So then I could say, okay, the constant duty case seems like the case. I've got, this is an E orifice. So I would go to my vendor and say, all right, this is my flow. This is what I've got. I think I need an E valve. And the vendor might look at that and say, you know what? I agree. I've got, you know, I think an E is about right. I've got a valve that should work for you. The valve I have, and I'm going to make these numbers up. Let's say I've got an orifice area of 0.192. And I have a discharge coefficient of 0.92. And I would say, that sounds good. Let me check it. If I wanted to then check this, I would go to the contingencies and I say, this is the case I'm concerned about. That is the higher flow case. So I want to copy it. I now have a copy of the constant duty. Oops. This one, though, I'm going to label as vendor check. I'm going to go to specifications. Instead of having a mass flow, though, I want to put in my vendor information. So I'm going to delete this mass flow, which allows me now to type in something like an effective discharge area. So I type in the effective discharge area. The vendor told me he had a valve that was 0.192 square inches. And it had a discharge coefficient of 0.92. I can then press solve cases here. You'll notice that the execute previously was not available, and it will calculate my cases. And it goes through and says, you can handle a flow of 1793. I then can go down here and I can look and compare and make sure that this valve will still work for me. If I had a flow that was this high, I can see that it'd be 97% utilized or 98% utilized, but that's okay. I don't believe I'm actually going to get that so much flow, but for the pressure drops, I will need those. So with that said, I can look at all this and I can say, all right, here are all my cases. This is what the vendor said, and I can make a decision whether this is the correct valve or not. And I can do it all in a very convenient location. I can see my pipeline pressure drops as well as valve characteristics. I can see what's happening in my stream as well as some valve properties. So with that said, those were the things that I wanted to show you within this block. As you can see, there's a lot of neat and useful things that have been combined together. There are a few other things I have not covered, for example, some of the relief valve standards, as well as national board data information. But if you do run into those cases, please let us know. We'd be happy to work with you.